In this video, we're going to talk a little bit more about WinCC SVG objects. We're going to learn about the structure of the SVGHMI files, and we're actually going to pull one out of the library and edit it so that we can add a property. Then we'll re-import it back into the project and animate it. So if this sounds interesting, let's get started. A few weeks ago, I did a video showing how to animate SVG objects in WinCC. These are just objects from the SVG library, the ones in version 2.0, which came out with version 7.5 of WinCC. You can animate these. They have properties that you can animate, and they have these folders, which are kind of different categories of equipment. There's some nice dashboard widgets here, so the one I'm kind of interested in is this divided bar display. And it's pretty easy to animate these. If we look at the properties, they typically have a property topic called symbol properties. Here we've got a color scale. This is kind of like a charging bar or a divided bar display. So we can animate this with a script or with tags. So here if we want our gradient to go from light green to dark green, we can do that. If we change our value, then you can kind of see what this object does. SVG objects are great because they have great performance. They are vector-based. Notice that I can scale this as big as I want, and it has no loss of resolution. And that is because this is a vector graphic. It is generated by code rather than by an image file. And so if you remember the Siemens HMI symbol library, this is an old system based on windowless ActiveXs. They don't really look that good anymore. You cannot use these objects with WebUX. So SVGs are kind of the way to go now. What I want to talk about in this video is to show you exactly what these objects are, and more importantly, how you can edit these objects, add your own properties, and use them in your WinCC and Unified projects. So first, let's take a look at what these SVG objects actually are. I'm going to open my project directory, and I'm going to open our graphics folder for this particular project, and you'll see an SVG library folder. And if we go in there, there is a version 1 and version 2, and we can go into the version 2, and looking at our library, it has the same folders. So if we look at accessories, you can see there's a lot of different things here. If I go into mine, I've only got a couple of things, so any particular file will not be there until you actually use that object. So you can see them popping in there as I use them. So you have to use them at least once for this file to be there. Now I want to look at this divided display here, and I got that out of the dashboard widget. So I'm going to open that folder. Here's my divided bar. So I'm going to go to the same place here, and there's my divided bar. Now I can actually open this up in any text editor. So this is the document that defines the divided bar display. Note that it has the file extension SVGHMI. This is a special file type that is defined by Siemens based on the SVG standard. This top part is called the document type declaration, so they're declaring it as a Siemens document type. And then we start our regular SVG definition. And this is your namespaces here. So it uses the standard SVG namespace, and then Siemens adds their own namespaces for the interface into the graphics designer. So we have a HMI namespace as well as an HMI bind, which is how we are able to interact with tags and scripts and things like that on the property interface. The next section is HMI self, and it is of type widget. And so basically this makes this object dynamic, and it works in the HMI customized widget control that is used by Siemens and Unified. So you have to give it a unique name, and you can give it a version if you like, and then you name your property interfaces for WinCC. So if you look at the names of these parameters, these are where we define the properties in our symbol properties for this object. So this is where they come from. If I were to add into this and then import this back in, I would see my new property. The next section is your definitions, and this is just for local variables, and this is why I chose this particular example. Here we've got a local variable called normalized value, and what it does is it takes into account your min and max range settings and your value property to define which bars are lit up. So as we change this value, different bars are going to be lit up. And so the way it works is it is defined by math for min and max range as well as value. This is your object definition here. This is your background. I actually went and translated that. This is your background. And first, it fills all six of your bars on the object with your background color. So it gets it sit from this color background here in our properties interface. And then this next section looks at each marker and decides whether or not it gets the background color or your scale one and scale two colors based on the value. And so the first line of the code looks at the normalized value and compares it against the upper range for this marker. And if it is equal to or greater than that is greater than, then it shows it inline, which means it will display. And if it is not up to that point, then we do none, which does not display it. If it is displayed, we create a linear gradient for this object, and we just give it a gradient from 0 to 1 of our color 1 scale and our color 2 scale. And then finally, we take that gradient and we paint this marker with these coordinates. And then we just do that for each marker, just changing our upper limit and our coordinates. So now let's take a look at another object. This particular object is under blowers and it is called the regenerative blower. And if we take a look at the properties here, we've got a basic and a contrast color. So our basic color here, so we'll just turn that green so you see what the basic color does. And then for our contrast color, I'll give it something else we can recognize. So notice that this little box thing up here never changes color. So let's add a property called electric box, which is what that is, and allow us to change the color of just that box. First, we need to go find the file for this particular object. So we're going to go to the graphics folder of our WinCC project, go into SVG library and our version 2.0 folder, and we'll go to the same path. So we'll go to blowers and it's the regenerative blower. Now what we're going to do, we cannot edit it directly here. We're going to copy this and then we will create a new folder. I'll just call it new SVGs and I will paste it into this folder. Next, I'm going to open this up with my text editor and we're going to save it as a new file name. So let's just call it with box. The first thing that we need to do is we have to change this name because these names have to be unique. So we're going to name it the same thing as we did the file. And I'll just copy this, and you have to update the extended name as well. The next thing we're going to do is add a parameter. So I'm just going to copy this, and we're going to call this property electric box color. It's going to be type HMI color, and we'll just give it the same default as our contrast color. Now this will show up in our properties interface. So the first thing we have to do is find out in the drawing code where our electric box is. And we know that it is not dynamic because it didn't change color. So the first thing I'm going to show you is that the hmi-bind directive, this is how we tie these properties up to the properties interface. So all of these objects that are using hmi-bind, this particular one is just using the basic color and creating a gradient for our connecting flange. So we know that this is not it. And there's a lot of code here, but don't let it throw you. And we're gonna come down to line 311, electric box. There is no HMI bind directive in here. So I'm pretty sure that this is it. And of course, yeah, I did a little bit of experimenting to make sure that this is it. So what we have to do is we have to use that property and set this electric box. And this is the color that it is. It's using a gradient. And so you can see the gradient is just defines the color. And then here we are defining the shape and it's using the URL function to take this gradient named shape 3 to give it its color, but the color is just hard coded here. So what we need to do is go copy a couple of HMI bind directives from another place and pop them in here. And it doesn't really matter which one that I have. We're just going to go from 0 to 1. So I can just copy these two lines here and come back down to my electric box. And I'm just gonna paste them right over here. And I'm just going to keep this 0 and 1. And instead of contrast color, we need to do electric box color, which is our new property. See, it populates right down in here. And then I will just copy that and paste this in. And we're going to give this, we're going to start at 0 and go to about 0.5, which is kind of a decent gradient. This is a small object. Now we are going to save this. So the next step is we have to import this into our SVG library. We can't just copy the file over. And the way we do this is we go back to Graphics Designer. I'm going to go to a new screen and I'll open the SVG library. And libraries have to be in a folder so you can pull them in from a zip file or a folder. So I'm just going to just do new library. I'm just going to call it WinCCGURU. And then here I can click in and you can see I right click and do import and I can pull in a graphic. Now, if I were to just do import from here, it doesn't give you the opportunity to do just a file. You have to go pull a folder. So I always like to just make a folder here. Right click, import SVG graphics. I am going to go to my desktop. Here's my new SVGs. And here's my new regenerative blower with box. I'm going to hit import and it should pop in here. And the fact that we have a picture means we didn't mess it up too badly. We're going to pull it out on the screen, make this a little bigger, and then go to our properties dialog. Here's our electric box color. I can double click this. We will pick a color and it does shade it. But what if we want to create our own SVG files? In the next video, I'm going to show you where you can download Inkscape, which is a free SVG editor, and install it on your computer. Then we will go through a simple example of creating a battery charge indicator SVG that we're going to make dynamic. We will review the Siemens documentation, find out more about the structure of the SVGHMI files, and take a look at some examples that they give. We'll also review the converter commands and math expressions that we can use to make our SVGs dynamic. Hey, if you enjoyed this video and learned something, I'd really appreciate you giving me a like and a subscribe. I'm going to be putting out 1 to 2 videos per week, so stay tuned.